Ladies and gentlemen, this is Let's Boogie One-on-One Beneath the Surface. I am so delighted today, and I'm so grateful. I have an iconic guest that's going to sit with me for a while, and we're going to talk a little bit about his illustrious career. I'm going to talk about him as personally as a musician and all of the great things and the great music that this gentleman has brought to the world. It's important that those of us who have lived with Kool & the Gang through our lifetimes, and then it's very important for the younger people that have come along now, that become very familiar with the people, the predecessors that paved the way, man. And it's real, real important. And one of the most important parts of this interview is that I want the young people to understand real music, real musicians, you know, people that really sing, and just the craft and how serious and committed you need to be in order to make it in the music industry. And with that, I'd like to welcome Mr. Robert Kool Bell, founder of Kool & the Gang, the iconic Kool & the Gang, to the Let's Boogie One-on-One show. Good evening. Good evening, my brother. How are you, man?
I'm just wonderful. How are you?
Great. So great to have you here. And as my opening stated, I believe everything I just said. I grew up on Kool & the Gang, as well as so many others. And it's so important that the younger people, and I think I heard an interview with you before, that, you know, understanding what's going on out here now in the music industry and where you come from in your history, you know, not only have you paved the way, but now you are a teacher by example of how success can be made, how it should be done the correct way. First thing I want to start with, I want to take you back because I looked at your Wikipedia. I did some history and from the things that I know, because I used to have your records. I used to be up Saturday morning cleaning it up, the Kool & the Gang, you know, in the house, man, and blasting the music. And I must have been about 14 years old, and you guys were rehearsing. I forget the name of the studio, but it was downtown here in New York. And my older brother is a percussionist, and he was in the other room with a band that he was with. And I got an opportunity to peek into your rehearsal, and that just blew me away, man. I didn't even come to see my brother no more. I was like, forget y'all, Kool & the Gang is here. So that was like a great memory of mine, you know. And I think that had to be somewhere around 78, 79. It might have been Sigma Studio or something. I can't really recall the name, but, you know, that was just a delight for me, you know. So here again, brother, welcome, man. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, can you just tell us, let's start at the beginning, because I always go back to the beginning. Kool & the Gang, Robert Kool Bell, your brother Ronald. How did it all get started? You know, where did you start from? I mean, because this is amazing.
Well, we started in 1964. Let me go back a little further.
Okay.
My brother and I, Ronald Kalish, as you know.
Yes.
We left Youngstown, Ohio. We were born in Youngstown, Ohio.
Wow, okay.
We left Youngstown, Ohio in 1960. And then in 64, that's when we met Dennis Thomas, also Spike Mickens,
mm-hmm.
In the projects of Jersey City.
Oh, okay, okay.
And we call ourselves the Jazzy X.
Okay, yeah, uh-huh.
And then we met George Brown, Vicki West, of course, Charles Smith. I mentioned Spike Mickens.
Right.
We got involved with an organization called the Soul Town Review.
Oh, okay.
Soul Town Review was trying to be like the Motown Review.
Ah, okay. I got it.
We became the Soul Town Band.
Gotcha.
So we had to learn the various songs that these groups were singing. Sometimes it would be 10 groups, sometimes it would be 15 groups. And wow. Most of the songs were Motown records.
Oh.
So we had to learn a lot of the Motown hits, you know.
Right.
Smokey Robinson, The Temptations, Junior Walker and All Stars. But then we also, there's a guy, he called Tiny Tim. He was like little James Brown.
Okay.
We had to learn a lot of James Brown.
Okay.
So Soul Town Band. we left that organization, and we were working in a club in Newark, New Jersey, the Blue Note Lounge.
Okay.
Out there on Broad Street. And one of the MCs for the Soul Town Review had this poster. And then the way that he made the poster, it was like cool and the flames.
So the flames.
You know, a brick of ice with cool and then the flames, and it was cool in the flames. Now, during that same time, right after that, we met a guy by the name of Gene Red. And Gene Red became my first manager.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Now, Gene Red's father had been working with James Brown. Mm. And so he said, well, we can't keep the name Cool in the Flames. Because we do not want to have any problems with the Godfather.
That's right. That's right.
Gene said, well, go back home and come back and with a different name you think that you should call yourselves. We came up with all kinds of crazy names. So Gene said, hey, listen. What about Cool and the Gang?
Cool and the Gang.
He said, hey, that kind of works. And so that's how we became Cool and the Gang. Now, Cool and the Gang was my middle name, nickname that I grew up with, you know, when I first moved to Youngstown, Ohio.
Oh, okay.
So, our very first record was Cool and the Gang. The album was Cool and the Gang. And we introduced ourselves to the industry as Cool and the Gang.
Wow.
1969, actually July 3rd, 1969. Mm-hmm. And so we're over 50 years, 51 years.
That's
back to 1964.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Wow.
Yeah.
God bless
you. That was the beginning. That took us to Cool in the Gang.
Okay, so now let me ask you this, because the name Cool in the Gang, now I know you know this, but I'm going to let the audience know. Here in New York, somebody asked me, how you doing? I said, everything is cool in the gang, man. Everything is cool in the gang. That became an iconic cultural phrase that we would use just in the streets. How did you realize that early on, or did it catch on? How did you feel about that? Because that's a word. I use that today. They asked me, hey, how you doing? Hey, I'm cool. Everything cool in the gang, man. How did you feel about that?
Somebody, I was just speaking to someone earlier, and they was telling me about the Michael Jordan movie. And there's a part in there where she's getting off the plane, I believe. Yeah. And I asked her what she's doing. She said, hey, man, everything's cool in the gang. You know, it was in the Pulp Fiction movie.
Yeah.
You know, that was the same.
That's excellent, man. That's excellent. I love it. Let me ask you this. What made you so cool? Where'd you get that name from? And did the group give you a hard time? I mean, obviously, you must have been the leader. We know that. Did anybody say, well, wait a minute, why has got to be Cool in the Gang? Can't it be somebody else in the gang? Why got to be me?
Well, I'm going to take you back. Too far back into that, because we have a vignette that's coming out, which is a documentary.
Oh, great.
Part of it is some of the story. Okay. Let me go back to Youngstown, Ohio, coming back to Jersey City. When our family moved to Jersey City, my mother sent me out to the store to get a loaf of bread. At that time, it was called Lucy Bread.
Okay.
I don't know if you remember that. Anyway, and it was a quarter. So I go out to get this bread. And these two guys walk up on me and say, man, give me your money. What? So they took my quarter.
Wow.
And so my mother said, boy, you better go back out there and get that quarter. I ain't going to deal with that. So what happened was I started hanging out with these guys. And one of the first names that we called ourselves was the Imperial Lords.
Oh, okay.
And my name was Tamango. I got Tamango from movie. You know, Dr. Danger's movie. When he came from Africa, and Tamango was a rebellious slave. He wasn't having it. I said, hey, I like that name. Because I wasn't having it out of somebody taking my money.
Right.
Okay, so It started as that. And wow. Then as we started to develop the group, and I decided to change my name. And there's this guy who called himself Cool. And he spelled it with a C.
Okay.
I like that. So I changed my name to Cool, and I spelled it with a K.
Okay.
One day, it was going to be a Cool in the A.
Gotcha.
So, yeah, the guys, you know, I said, well, why Cool? It was how it went, the evolution of how things happen. You know, I come up from the street.
Right.
We become Cool in the Gang. Now, I went from not a real bad gang, but we had to defend ourselves, about 40 strong.
No doubt.
To a Cool in the Gang.
There you go.
To a good gang.
Wow, that's amazing. That's how it happened. That's amazing. That's amazing, man. You know what? Your brother Ronald. Let me ask you this: how many siblings were you? How many siblings?
It was six
of you.
Yeah, five boys and one girl.
Okay. Anybody else played music? Anybody sang, played music, entertained?
Well, my brother Amir. Okay. Yeah, called the KGs.
Oh. Okay.
Bumping.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh, that's your brother. Okay.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. We started a label called Game Records.
Okay.
And we introduced the KGs on that label.
Got you. Now, your brother Ronald, man, y'all been riding together, man, for a long time, man. Tell me about that, man, because I have a brother, and we're close, man. And you know, we've been riding this thing until the wheels fall off. What's that experience? What's going through this with your brother, man, through the years, the ups, the downs? You know, it a brotherly thing, because a lot of people will say, well, you know, people are not close like they were, or, you know, explain that relationship with you and your brother Ronald, man.
Well, you know, like you said, I mean, brothers sometimes fight and have arguments and, you know, don't see eye to eye sometimes.
Right.
My mother always was the one that told us, hey, you know, you guys better stick together.
Right.
And coming from the whole Tamango thing, the Cool thing, you know, I was kind of like protecting my brother. My brother felt good by the fact that, wow, my brother, man, you got 30 knuckleheads he's running around the project. So he knew that if anybody messed with him,
right,
I had his back.
Right, got you.
So, you know, going on through life, you know, we had different opinions and different ways of how we want to do things. But you always got to sit down and got to work it out.
Got to work it out. I feel you.
Every problem, as the French says, there is a solution. Okay, we got a problem. Okay, so let's work this problem out.
Right.
That kind of flowed into Cool in the Gang and my members and my partners. I mean, because, you know, we start off with 7-3 pass. So, you know, you're going to have your up and down. We're not going to agree on everything.
Right.
But we always remember what our parents told us.
Okay.
Look for the solution.
That's all. Beautiful. Wow, that's an amazing journey. You know, when did you first, who started playing music first? You started together, or did you start and then he came in, or who started first?
Well, it's somewhat, I would say we started together.
Okay.
When we were in Youngstown, we used to get these old paint cans. And the paint cans, depending on how much paint was left in the can, had certain tones.
Oh, really? Yeah. Wow.
Sit on this little hill by this Catholic church called Immaculate. And we used to beat those cans and as it echoed down. It was on a little hill, so it used to echo down in the valley. So,
Wow.
It was like playing bongos, not steel drums, but bongos. And so I guess we started together. But then, of course, when we moved to Jersey City, and you go to a grammar school, and at that time, they had music in the school.
That's right, yeah.
I got the cello. I like it. I tried to mess with the violin. I didn't like it. Tried to mess with the mellophone. Somehow I look like playing this thing. My brother, I think he had a cello one time, but he liked the saxophone.
Okay.
And that's how he started playing saxophone.
Wow, that's amazing. When did you really realize, all right, you get the guys together, the first group of guys from Kool & the Gang. When did y'all say to yourselves, or when did you truly realize in your own mind that I think we got something here, man? I think that we can go somewhere with this.
I think it happened with the first record.
Really?
Kool & the Gang. Because we put it together. Of course, you know, from Soul Town and Kool & the Flame, be like jazz and R&B and funk. Mm-hmm. But the Kool & the Gang record did quite well, actually. It was the top 40 pop record.
Wow, really? Wow, okay.
They thought it was a Spanish band because, you know, we had the Boggles in there and, you know, we had the street talk. Hey, cool, what, man? I saw your old lady last night. If you listen to the record,
yeah,
that was the vibe.
Okay.
I guess it became a street thing and Jersey City grasped it and it became, you know, a pretty good record. Now, of course, there was ups and downs. After that, the album, we had songs like Funky Granny, Reason Soul, Sea of Tranquility, which D'Angelo did quite well with that song.
Oh, okay.
Captured the song and had a nice big record on that. So, but we were like territorial, I would say. You know, our music was known like in Philadelphia, you know, New York, New Jersey, maybe we got down as far as Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. But I really didn't have that big record yet. So,
right.
By the way, we signed to Delight Records through Gene's company called Redcoats. So, they came to us one day and they said, listen, you guys, you know, you've been having some territorial hits, you know, mm-hmm. like those cities I just mentioned. He said, but there's a guy who just produced Mongo Domingo, Soul Makusa.
Right, Soul Makusa, yeah.
And I got it. They came to us and they said, hey, we like this guy to work with you guys and produce you. So we had one meeting and we weren't fit. So one day, New York, went down to a studio called Baggies, down in the village. We went there around 8 o'clock in the morning, and we started rehearsing and jamming. And by the time we finished, we had created Funky Stuff, Jungle Boogie,
wow,
and Hollywood Swinging.
Oh, really? Wow. In one day?
No more, one day, no more problems from the record company after that.
I know that's right.
Wow. I beat for about 8 weeks.
Wow.
And Hollywood Swinging and Jungle Boogie was top five.
That's right. Oh, yeah, I remember those.
So that's when, to answer your question, that's when it really started. I mean, you know, we was around and doing this and doing that, but after those records, it took us to another level.
That's amazing, man. Now let me ask, after that success of those couple of records there, what was your first big tour? What was your first big tour immediately after the success of that record?
It was around that time, right? 75, 76.
Okay.
We went out. We had the Gap Band was on the show with us, the Bar K's, a few of the other groups. That became a big tour for, because, you know, Hollywood Swing and Jungle Boogie.
Yeah, that was popping. That was popping, boy. Yeah, man. That was popping. That
first big one.
Now, how did you feel? I mean, like, when you guys get on stage, practice, when you have to rehearse and put the shows together, do you do it yourself, or do you bring somebody in that helps with the production and coordinating everything? How does that work?
We pretty much, you know, do it ourselves.
Okay.
I have to go back to Kool & the Gang record with Gene Red. He came up with this little idea of, you know, how he had us dress, and we played at the Apollo Theater.
Now
you gotta move, spell Kool & the Gang, move your horns, because we didn't have no singers. We said, yeah, okay. Because, you know, you gotta realize we came from playing jazz.
Right.
Backup band.
Right.
So we tried to get into it. You know, we had the hit record. Then there was a group in New York called Willie Feaster.
Willie Feaster.
Mighty Magnificence. And Skip Sonny. and the Pace Brothers.
Wow, okay.
About 11 of those guys, like four of them was like the singing group. All it was like the singing group and the band together.
Right, okay.
And they blew us away. They ran us back to Jersey City. This is not just about playing.
Yeah.
Put a show together.
Gotcha.
That is what ran us. That's when we started to produce our own show.
Gotcha. You know, I remember, you know, I was actually at the Apollo years ago when it was Kool & the Gang and the Commodores. You remember that show?
Yeah, we played with the Commodores several times.
Yeah, it was at the Apollo. I'll never forget that, man. That was
and great. Ohio Players.
And Ohio, yeah, you know what? That's right. That was great.
Ohio Players, too.
That was a great show, man. That was a great show. The other question, I was told to ask you this question. The record, Who's Gonna Take the Weight? I understand there's a story behind that record. Who's Gonna Take the Weight? Could you tell us about that one?
Well, the story today about what's going on right now, Who's Gonna Take the Weight? Mm-hmm. Everything going on right now with Black Lives Matter and now.
Yeah.
But Who's Gonna Take the Weight? We're rehearsing uptown in Jersey City, we call it Up on the Hill. Mm-hmm. And we're rehearsing. And the guy that we were rehearsing with, he was a good dancer. So we're trying to put a show together. And he's trying to show us some new steps and choreography and all that. And while we're doing that, these two cops come downstairs. We were rehearsing in the basement. And they were like the Starsky and Hutch guys. And they came downstairs. And they looked around, and they were over here in the corner. They said, "What's this?" I said, "What's what?" And then they went another color, "What's this?" And it was, at that time, it was called smack or doogie. It was drugs. And I think they really was setting up.
Mm-hmm.
Her name was Jinx, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But we got caught up in it.
Right. So,
We got arrested that night.
Wow.
The question was, well, who's gonna take the weight? I said, they're not our drugs.
That's right. That's right. So
we wrote the song. We had a concert the next day too. But who's gonna take the
weight? Wow. I feel you.
That's the story that I think you was looking for.
Got you. That's amazing, man. Wow, because I heard about that. And I said, let me ask you that question. You know, now that segues to this, you know, where we're at today with all that you see that's going on. First of all, we're in a pandemic here, a pandemic that is just unprecedented. It's just amazing and mysterious and scary and all the different things. And then also the police brutality, the racism, the protests. You know, what's your take on that? How did it affect you as a person, your family, your business, you know, and just in general, your thoughts on where we're at today?
Well, definitely it has affected, you know, our business. Mm-hmm. Because I'm down here in Florida, in Orlando, they call it O-Town.
Right.
And so I'm on lockdown in O-Town.
Yeah, it's crazy down there. Yeah.
It's got really bad. I've been down here for 4 months now.
Mm.
You know, so and we lost a lot of shows. Looks like we're not going to work until next year.
Wow.
And a lot of other groups too.
Yeah.
So it makes you kind of realize that you have to kind of, you know, work together. Families need to work together, stay together. Mm-hmm. You know, and then some of our songs before our bigger hits in the 80s. Like love and understanding.
Love and understanding.
Higher planes. You know, he spoke about people all over the world. It's time for love and understanding. It's time to come together. Not only families to come together, but what's going on out there right now?
Yeah.
Black Lives Matter. And that it became more than just Black Lives. It
right.
became a movement.
Yes.
Black, Asian, Chinese, you know.
Right.
And so songs like Love and Understanding and Higher Plane, some of the songs that we wrote, and Who's Gonna Take the Weight?
Who's Gonna Take the Weight, that's right.
Yeah, people, who's gonna take the weight for what's going on right now?
That's right.
With all these problems. Of course, the virus is the virus. You know, I mean, that's out of our control. Only God knows.
Right. True indeed. True indeed. Yeah.
All these other things that's happening, you know, it's really time to come together. Now, we're working on a song, and it's called World Peace.
Oh, okay.
I want to hook us a pursuit of happiness. And it will be coming out soon. It's like, who's going to take the weight to a love and understanding, to a celebration in the world peace?
Ah, beautiful.
That we're working on.
Beautiful, beautiful, man. When do you see that coming out?
Probably September, October.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Coming up in 4 years out, yeah.
Good, 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 good. Yeah, I look forward to that, man. I definitely look forward to that because we need to hear from the people that have the platforms. You know, a lot of times people want to lay back and don't really want to say anything, but you have a platform. You're recognized as something, and a message needs to be sent, especially not to, you know, people say always to the young people, but I tell them this, I'm still here. You know, I'm grown, but I can always learn. I can always, you know, get some encouragement. I can always get some hope and faith from someone else. So I'm open to everything that's positive. You know what I'm saying? And I understand the negative side too, because you learn from that as well. But at the end of the day, we have to push forward no matter what. You know, we're still here. We're still living. We still got to go. So, you know, yeah, that'd be great to hear from Kool and the Gang. And like I said early in the opening, you know, the younger people that might not be familiar as much as I am with Kool and the Gang, they need to know you guys, man. And that's a way also for them to get to know you. And I know you've worked with other artists and younger artists and, you know, did collaborations on some of your hits with them. I saw that as well. Mm-hmm. Can you speak on that a little bit? Some of the artists, the younger artists that you worked with and you did some of your hits with them and some remixes and stuff like that.
Well, there's been a lot of sampling, you know, with our music, as you know. Tribe Called Quest, P. Diddy and Mace did Hollywood Swinging.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah,
that was dope. Yeah, they did that.
Was Will Smith with Summertime.
Oh, come on, you know.
Madness. Grammy, he won a Grammy with that one.
That's Latin crazy. Record. Wow, yeah. That is crazy, man. That was a big record for him. How do you, internally, I know, how do you feel about someone taking your records and doing what they do with it? Your real feelings about it, you know, how do you feel about that? How did it make you feel?
Well, it becomes an extension of what we have created. Mm-hmm. Okay. In the earlier days before, you know, they passed a law about copyright infringement, and record companies could not put a record out until they get copyright clearance.
Right.
You know, so on that side, it helped us because there was a lot of sampling going on. I mean,
absolutely.
I mean, who really knew? I mean, we had to put somebody out on sample patrol. Catch that lick. Get that lick. But again, it became a extension of what we did. Someone would sample something that we did, and then they would create something new from that sample.
Right.
So
right.
It was like an extension. We probably would never played that song that way.
Right, right.
Knowing that existed. But someone knew, the younger people that's been sampled, they said, yeah, well, this is what I hear. I just want the drum beat. Give me the bass line, you know, or give me the guitar lick, and I take it and create something else for you.
Right.
From that perspective, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's just an evolution of music. It's a part of our growth.
Right. Now, the artistic side of it, when I look at what you guys do, you create every note, you create every lick, you create every beat, the whole concept, the melody and everything. When someone comes along and they now sample, do you give it the same, how could I say, the same accomplishment, respect as you would someone that's actually doing it from scratch and what have you?
Well, I mean, they're using today's ability and high tech in terms of music, you know, in terms of sampling, how they take it electronically, you know, with a drum machine or putting the different vibes. So I think that's a talent within itself there. But I understand, I think, where you're coming from, that they have not been through, you know, learning the song and learning the grooves and creating the music and being able to play it. Like a lot of stuff, they can't play live.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Sample machine with them.
Right. You know?
But the way we do it, and due respect to Ohio Players, Earth, Wind, Fire, or Parliament Funkadelics, you know, we play.
Right. Right, right, right. That's important because it seems like they take a shortcut to me, even though this is their, you know, the new way of doing things. I understand and I respect it, but it's kind of like a shortcut to me to get to a point. You take the, you know, you take the faster road, but do you really understand the content of what you're actually doing? So I think they kind of miss out a little bit, even though this is what they do. You know, give me some of your favorite young artists today that you probably might even want to work with. That you like, you know, today's artists. Anybody that you like?
Well, of course, everybody knows Bruno Mars.
Yeah, bad boy.
That's like a young cool again.
Bad boy.
You know, from the steps, the move, the horn legs, you know. Yeah, we really like what he's been doing.
Nice, nice, nice.
It's been, they're not that young, but I used to look up to what they were doing. And that was Mint Condition.
Make it this and bad boys right there. Yeah. Yeah.
That's really what was playing and really got, they really understood what it's all about. Yeah.
Right, 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 right.
Yeah. Other groups, you know, like Usher did his thing. And,
yeah.
You know, Jermaine Dupri and that whole Atlanta vibe, you know. So, I mean, it's all kind of music out there.
Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. You know what, back in the day, one of the groups that I loved was Mandrill. Mandrill was a great group, and they had, you know, they had a good groove. I had that record. See, back then it was so many groups, man. That was, I mean, it was just the music in general was just, I mean, the icons today were young back then that became these icons of the Stevie Wonders, the Kool and the Gangs. You know, you guys were young, man, and it was the soundtrack of our lives, man, as we was coming up. You know, my brother's your age, so my brother's like maybe 7 years older than me. So, I saw the maturation and all of the accomplishments, and it gave me hope. It gave me, how can I put it, man? It gave me a sense of pride, to be honest with you, when I saw people like me doing the things that you guys were doing. You know, all around the world, and the effect. I don't know if you realize, Mr. Bell, the effect that your music has had on people. And I know you get awards, and I know you know, but I'm talking about street people. I'm talking about people from the hood. I'm talking about people from the projects, people that live in Harlem and Brooklyn and Bedford-Stuyvesant and Crenshaw, the streets. You know, it resonates. It really makes a difference because we feel like you are us. You're representing us, and we can relate. How does that make you feel?
That makes us feel very good. It makes me feel very good.
Yeah.
You mentioned Mandrill. Right now, my partner and I, we're working with Mandrill. Right now, Mandrill's coming up with an album next year.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah, we got a production deal going to London.
Yeah. Nice.
We're working with Doc and all those guys.
Okay, okay, okay.
But yeah, what you just said, how it makes us feel like that fact that our music survived. You know, different neighborhoods, different, you know, genres of music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have songs that cross over to the pop charts or even to the rock charts to some degree. Songs like Misled or Emergency.
Right.
Had
right.
that sort of rock vibe to it as well.
Right.
And we have been blessed to be able to work with all type of groups. For instance, we did 48 shows with Van Halen.
Yes, yes.
We did 10 shows with Kid Rock.
Wow.
The Dave Matthews Band. We worked with Rod Stewart, Meatloaf, Dire Straits. Then we turn around and rock with Stevie Wonder. Or Clinton. Clinton. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We're able to fix it up. And that's a blessing. We can feel that's a blessing.
That's incredible. Now I look at your career as I research too, and then also listening to the music. Jazz was a very important part of your upbringing in music. Is that your first love, playing jazz, or how do you feel about jazz? Because it seems like you called yourself the Jazzy X, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so and you said you played with Soul Town and y'all did jazz and backed people up. Was that where you really was at? How did it mature to and move on and stuff like that? Because I think people really want to hear about that because your jazz background is heavy.
I would say for me, it was jazz and R&B.
Okay.
Now, my brother loved John Coltrane. So, you know, he was played sax and twang with Chamber of Dawn. And then, Cannibal Alley, DT was into Cannibal. I listened to Ron Carter, Paul Chambers. Also, the bass player that Jameson that did a lot of those tracks, Motown tracks, you know. So right. That was our early influences. I would say jazz and R&B.
There you go. Now, speaking of jazz, I saw something about your father and your uncle being boxers. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes.
And then Theolius Monk was somewhere around the area somewhere? In your...
Yeah, he became my godfather.
Okay, okay.
The old, on the, what's it? That would be the west side of New York.
Okay, okay.
64th Street.
Right, it's right.
The gym over there.
Right.
And of course, apartment buildings. So My father and my uncle, they used to train over there. And Miles Davis, you know, he wanted to be a fighter.
Yeah,
that in his movie, and he would want to come over and spar with my father. But my father was pounds. I spar with you a little bit, but I gotta be careful. I don't want to bust your lip and then mess up your career. My father used to box a lot of Cuban fighters.
Oh, okay.
Cuba, and then when I was born. That's when he asked Monk to be my godfather. And Monk became my godfather.
Wow, that's...
He didn't know I was going to be a bass player.
Oh, right.
He named me, they gave me a nickname because there was a bass player and keyboard player, Dodo Monterroso El Riquico. I said, what kind of name is that? You know, but that was a bass player, famous bass player in Cuba. And that became my nickname also.
Wow. Have you ever been to Cuba yourself? Have you ever performed there?
Yeah. We finally went there.
Okay. Excellent. Yeah.
Excellent. 250,000 people came because that's when they lifted the sanctions and we was able to go to Cuba.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. You know, I always ask this question personally for you. What was the highlight or two or three highlights of your career that really just like blew you away? You said, wow, this is amazing.
Well, I would say the first highlight was when we won the American Music Award, Ladies Night, after coming with our first record with a lead singer. I was James J.T. Taylor.
Right.
And at that particular time, music was changing. But right before that, we had been out on the tour with the Jackson 5.
Okay.
A guy by the name of Dick Griffin.
Dick Griffin.
He said, you know what? You guys are doing great on this tour, but I think you need to get a lead singer. And we said, lead singer. He said, Dick, you might be right. Because our horns was like our singers. Because we always had a sound that was a Kuna Gang sound.
Right. You know,
okay. So we said, okay, we'll try that. And that's when JT happened to know the owners of the studio, the House of Music, West Orange, New Jersey. And Diodato was there because he was working on the project.
Mm-hmm.
And JT came by the studio. So my brother said that. Let me hear you, you know, I'm play some chord changes and let me get your vibe on it. So my brother played a little jazz, a little funk, and JT hung in there. So
Anyway,
he became the lead singer. Right. We didn't audition nobody else.
Well, that's what I was gonna ask you. Yeah, I was gonna ask that. Wow. Okay.
Now, while we're doing the record, my wife and I used to hang out in New York. And we used to go to the Studio 54 in Eugene's. And the jeans, I should say. And I came back to the group. I said, I got two ideas, two concepts. They said, what? I said, ladies' night.
Okay. Okay.
64th Street.
Right, right.
The gym over there.
Right.
And of course, apartment buildings. So My father and my uncle, they used to train over there. And Miles Davis, you know, he wanted to be a fighter.
Yeah.
Over that in his movie. And he would want to come over and spar with my father. But my father's pals come up. I spar with you a little bit, but I got to be careful. I don't want to bust your lip and then lift up your career. Then my father used to box a lot of Cuban fighters.
Oh, okay.
Cuba. And then when I was born, that's when he asked Monk to be my godfather. And Monk became my godfather.
Wow, that's...
He didn't know I was going to be a bass player.
Oh, right.
He named me, they gave me a nickname because there was a bass player and keyboard player, Dodo Monterroso El Riquico. I said, what kind of name is that? You know, but that was a bass player, famous bass player in Cuba. And that became my nickname also.
Wow. Have you ever been to Cuba yourself? Have you ever performed there?
Yeah. We finally went there.
Okay. Excellent. Yeah. Excellent.
250,000 people came because that's when they did the sanctions and we was able to go to Cuba.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. You know, I always ask this question personally for you. What was the highlight or two or three highlights of your career that really just like blew you away? You said, wow, this is amazing.
Well, I would say the first highlight was when we won the American Music Award, Ladies' Night, after coming with our first record with a lead singer. I was James A.G. Taylor.
Right.
And at that particular time, music was changing. But right before that, we had been out on the tour with the Jackson 5.
Okay.
A guy by the name of Dick Griffin.
Dick Griffin.
Who had four records. He said, you know what? You guys are doing great on this tour, but I think you need to get a lead singer. And we said, lead singer. He said, Dick, you might be right. Because our horns was like our singers. Because we always had a sound that was a Kuna Gang sound.
Right.
Okay. So we said, okay, we'll try that. And that's when JT happened to know the owners of the studio, the House of Music, West Orange, New Jersey. And Diodato was there because he was working on the project.
Mm-hmm.
And JT came by the studio. So my brother said, yeah. Let me hear you, you know, I'm playing some chord changes and we get your vibe on it. So my brother played a little jazz, a little funk, and JT hung in there. So,
Anyway,
he became the lead singer. Right. We didn't audition nobody else.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. Yeah, I was going to ask that. Wow. Okay. Okay.
Now, while we're doing the record, my wife and I used to hang out in New York. And we used to go to the Studio 54 in Eugene's. And Eugene's, I should say. And I came back to the group. I said, I got two ideas, two concepts. They said, what? I said, ladies' night. I said, so every Friday, Saturday, Sunday night in New York, it's ladies' night.
Yes.
And the other one was hanging out. But that's what I was doing. And when we did that record, that was our very first record. So getting back to the question, Ladies' Night became such a big record.
Huge.
Ricky Parker broke that record in New York.
Mm-mm-mm.
That became the record.
To this day.
Right. Now, we won the American Music Award for Ladies' Night. So that was a highlight, because that was a highlight to where they were. I said that disco is dead, disco fucking the whole 9 yards. We made our change, Cantonese singer, came up with a song called Ladies Night about two American music awards. That was a highlight.
Wow, wow, that's nice.
That's second nice. Highlight in Kenya. And we played for Glaxon Klein, who's one of the pharmaceutical companies that was there. And the whole concept was no glove, no love.
Okay.
For AIDS awareness, trying to get these kids, you know, to kind of protect themselves. And we drew 500,000 people.
Whoa, wow.
They're right in front of the Medical Center of Health there. And that was such a great highlight.
That's amazing. You know, I'm looking at the awards. Now we're talking about awards. And correct me if I'm wrong. I see 2 Grammy Awards. Is that correct?
Yes.
I see 7 American Music Awards.
Yes.
I see a Music Business Association Chairman Award. That's correct. I see inducted into the New Jersey Hall of Fame. I see a Soul Train Music Award. I see a Marvin Anderson Award.
That was Philly. That was a great one.
Wow. Yeah. Now I don't who is Mary? Is it Marion Anderson? Yeah. Who is that? Who's that?
Well, she was a singer in Philly, and she's an actress, you know, very well loved in Philadelphia. She did a lot for the city.
Gotcha. Right. Now I see an award here that I know is very, very special to you. It says Bell, Brown, and Taylor, Songwriters Hall of Fame, man. Now out of all these accolades, which one touches you the most? Which one? Well, I know you're proud of all of them, but if you had to pick one, which one would it be?
The Songwriters Hall of Fame.
That's what I thought.
Competing with your writers, and it's not easy to write a song to get a hit.
Right.
You know, when you got so many songs, so many writers.
Right.
You inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame. That was a good accomplishment for us. I mean, because, you know, a lot of people said to us, and we have, when you guys are going to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Well, maybe one day.
But, Should have already been there.
Yeah. Songwriters Hall of Fame is definitely.
Yeah. You know, another thing too, I'm very big on our history, you know, and I know it's entertainment and I know it's about, you know, people having a good time, but your personal legacy, your music legacy is a part of Black history. And I know you know that. And I just want to make sure that the people understand that watch this, and especially our youth, because this is a part of Black history where we're all said and gone. When we're all done and gone, Kool and the Gang will live on. And it's a part of the legacy to once again teach them and show them where they come from, because a lot of what we go through is people not knowing where they come from. So I want to segue to this, brother, and correct me once again, you're a practicing Muslim, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. How do you pronounce your name? Because I don't want to mispronounce the name. I know it's Muhammad. How do you pronounce the last name?
Bayan. B-A-Y-Y-A-N. Bayan.
Okay. Right. I thought that I knew about that, but when I read it, I said, well, I'm not going to mispronounce the brother's name. I'm going to ask him how to say it. And can you expound a little bit on that? How has that helped you in your journey?
Well, over the years, turned to trying to keep a clear head, because, you know, in this music business, it can be up and down, a lot of different things coming at you. So it kind of helped me and my brother to be stable and practicing Islam, which is a way of life.
Yes. Know?
That's really what it really is, trying to live a good way of life.
Right.
You know, I mean, because we were back during the time with the Nation of Islam, which some of us know, some of us might not know, Elijah Muhammad, books like How to Eat to Live. We taught about, you know, people coming together, brothers and sisters coming together, only on business, you know, we went to steakhouse and you know, Bean Pies and Enterprise, and you know. So it has helped, you know.
Yeah, that's
you know, that's how you deal with the world. And Islamically, you look at people all over the world. If you go travel to the Middle East, you'll see Chinese Muslims, you see Indian Muslims, you see Caucasian Muslims, etc. We're just people.
Right.
We're just people. And, you know, that's what world peace is going to be about when that record comes out.
Wow. That's heavy. Can't wait to see that, brother. Can't wait to see that. Now, I want to get to a little bit real quick because I'm not going to hold you too much longer, but the career, I see the change in the music. I see the instrumental, the lead singer, you know, and where you're at today and how you evolved and you kept with the times and you kept changing and keeping yourselves relevant, which is very hard to do for a lot of people. Couldn't do that. They couldn't stay. That's why they're not around as long as you guys have been. There was a period where there was a low period where from the Jungle Boogie Hollywood Swinger to now when you get the lead singer, you guys just went on a run. You guys went on a run with these hits. I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, in a good way, but wow, there was hit after hit after hit after hit. How was that for you guys? I know you was blown away.
Yeah, that was, again, like I said, that was a blessing. Because that transition was right 68, 69. JT came in the band 69. Mm-hmm. That was right when the industry was changing and they were talking about dance music and disco music, and it was anti-dance and disco music, and they were burning albums at that time in Chicago and the state. All that was kind of like going on.
Right.
And so we had to kind of, you know, find our way through all of that.
Right.
You know, because we had songs like Open Sesame, which was good for us, actually.
Yeah.
Open Sesame became a part of Saturday Night Fever.
Right.
So, you know, it was one of your biggest albums until Michael Jackson came along with Thriller. So my brother who wrote those horn parts, you have to figure, well, how can we keep our integrity and also put it on the dance floor?
Mm.
And that's what Open Sesame became, a record that if you change the beat, put a swing beat to it, it would be jazz. That's how we slipped through the cracks and made our way into the 80s.
Right. Course, okay.
After that, you said it, like Ladies Night, Get Down On It, Cherish, Reggae Dancing, Misled, Tonight. You know, I can only say one thing. Yeah, all praises due to God for that.
There you go. That's excellent. One of my favorites is Summer Madness. You know, I was playing that earlier, getting myself in the mood. You know, I was getting in the cool in the game mood. And then I played Get Down On It, which is, I DJ sometime. And that's one of my go-to tunes in terms of, you know, the mature crowd getting on the floor. You know, and then, you know, be honest with you, the young people, they love it too. It doesn't matter. It's no age barrier. When you play Get Down On It, when you play Jungle Boogie, you know, a lot of these kids do know this music, you know, and I'm like, wow, okay, that's a good thing. But Summer Madness is just something, the melodic take on that song is hypnotizing, you know, and it's still relevant, man. So that's a great song, man. Yes, that's a really great song. Now I want to ask you this, moving forward, we're here today, 2020, with what we're faced with now, no concerts, social distancing, all this crazy stuff that's going on. Have you ever thought about doing a virtual concert with the band? You guys putting on something online?
Yeah, we're thinking about something like that.
Yeah,
We kind of got together and we did a virtual show for the Apollo Theater.
Oh, okay.
For the Apollo.
Okay.
We all play from our home virtually.
Right.
And we did something with Sirius Radio.
Oh, okay.
Virtually. But now we want to take it to the next step.
Yeah. Right, go to the stage together.
Yeah.
Safely, that'd be cool. Now, what was your biggest selling hit? What was the biggest selling record or album? First, the biggest selling album, and then the biggest selling single. What was that?
Well, it had to be a celebration. It's the biggest selling single.
There you go. Celebration.
Album, the emergency album, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
The album Celebration, or we called it Celebrate. That was a big album for us.
Right.
No, we had a couple. In the Heart was another big album for
us. The Heart, okay. What was, out of all these songs, out of all the compositions, out of all the material, what was your favorite songs? Three songs that you can give me. Three songs out of what you put together. What was your favorites, if you had to pick them?
Excuse me for a minute.
Sure.
One had to be Summer Madness.
Ah, okay. I feel you.
And then Hollywood Swinging. And of course, the Ladies Tonight.
Ladies, there you go. Yeah. You gotta bring the ladies, no doubt about it. No doubt about it. Absolutely. You have any children? How many children do you have?
I only have two children. I have two sons and I have two grandchildren.
Are they musicians? Your sons musicians?
No, my son Hakeem, he goes by the name of Prince Hakeem. He's a DJ, producer / rapper.
I think I've heard of him. I've heard of him. Yeah, okay.
And Jermaine Dupri and my other son, Muhammad, they all run together.
Okay, got you. A word to the youth, people in general, moving forward. Two things. Where do you see the music industry going from this point moving forward in terms of records, concerts, the approach, and all that kind of stuff? If I had to ask Robert Kubel, as a newcomer, what would you tell me moving forward in this business?
Well, that's a pretty tough question there, based on what's going on right now. You know, when, a concert has been canceled because of the pandemic, you know, and I don't know which way it's totally going to go. Mm-hmm. Some of the younger artists who might understand the whole social media, it can become more virtual. You know, concerts might be done in one place and then shown all over the world.
All over the world, yeah.
It can be in 3D, it can be a lot of different. It's hard to say now to figure out which way it's going to go. Mm. Now, we would all love to go back to see you play in front of 5,000 people, 500 people, or 50,000 people back to the stadium, back to where it was maybe just about a year ago.
Right.
We had a tour set up that we had to cancel 20 shows.
Wow.
Europe. And we're talking about 10,000, 20,000, 30,000. Mm. We just did a big show. We had over 50,000. It was, I'm trying to think, it was like the Institute, can't think of the name of the big festival they had up in New York. Mm. Years ago, Jimi Hendrix and all those guys were there. What was that called? The
Woodstock? Not Woodstock, is it?
No. Yeah. Woodstock? They had a European Woodstock.
Oh, okay.
And they had over 50,000 people there.
Wow.
So, God willing, maybe 2021, everything comes back together again, we'll be back out there again.
But, back out there.
It's a hard question because I'm saying that don't lose hope. Continue to do what you're doing, write music, and actually, because the younger people know how to work to social media more so than what we do, especially what I do. You know, that's a whole new world out there. You know, so keep doing what you do, and sooner or later they come around again.
Right. Now, you mentioned before, too, about a documentary that you guys, about yourselves. Is that completed, or are you working on it, or when is it coming out? When is that going to be available?
Well, we're working on it now. There's two segments that's out now that you can get on YouTube.
Okay.
No, it's animated. Part of it is animated, and part of it is real time with us talking about our career.
Okay.
So I would say that by the top of the year, six, seven, eight, nine episodes of it, you know, it's the Cool in the Game documentary.
Well, that's gonna be good. You ever thought about now that documentary? You turn that documentary, you see how they make these movies about these iconic groups and what have you. When is the movie coming out? When's the movie coming out?
Well, that's all part of it. You know, we wanted to do a book.
Okay.
We have already met with a couple of writers and ghostwriters in terms of that. We have a lot of information that we've been doing, that we've been compiling. And then we have this animated documentary, and that can lead up
right
to the movie.
Right, right.
My working title for the movie is Hollywood Swinging.
Hollywood Swinging. I feel you. That sounds good.
And you have the billboard charts.
Okay.
What is the other side of the industry?
That's real.
The Italian side, Jewish side, that's real.
Okay. Awesome. Okay, that's a whole nother story, isn't it?
That's a whole nother story.
I feel you. You know what I'm going to ask you, too, before I let you go, is you had different members through the years. Now, and this is a tough question, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but you had different members through the years. What was the time period for the best unit that you feel out of all the members that you've had, and this is not to shun anyone, this is just to get clarification, that you felt was the tightest unit of Kool & the Gang at any one period through all these years? Well, answer it a couple of different ways. I don't want to put you on the spot.
Well, I think the 70s was a good time for us because we had the original members, the original band, and we didn't really have any singers, so it was more about the music, more about the horns, more about the funk.
Right, right.
When we had Hollywood Swinging and Jungle Boogie and Funky Stuff and Spirit of the Boogie. And then when we was able to slip into a jazzier side with Summer Madness.
There you go. Gotcha.
They are fans now. Matter of fact, I did an interview during this whole pandemic one night and said, he said to the audience, if you want to hear Joanna or Cherish, he said, don't tune in. I'm going to take you back to songs that you didn't know about.
Right, right. And
songs that I forgot we had recorded.
Mm.
Bag and paid Funky Granny. He played Funky Man. He played Sea of Tranquility. He went you to Lyman. He played Pneumonia. I said, I forgot we did all.
Wow.
That love affair and... And that's what it was. It was the 70s was really, even we do a live show, okay, we come up with the hits in the beginning. Whenever we go back to the 70s and we hit them with Hollywood Swinging, Funky Stuff, Jungle Boogie, Open Up to Me, and Summer Madness, we got them.
Got them.
Of course, when we go to Ladies Night, Get Down on a Celebration, that closes it out.
Right.
Yeah, that was a good period for us, too.
Nice, man. Nice. You guys accomplished a lot. I remember seeing you a couple of years. It might have been maybe 3 years ago, 3-4 years ago, at the casino in Queens here in New York. You remember that show? You Resorts World Casino. You guys were up there.
Yeah, good place.
Yeah. That was a great show, man. Great show. Always good seeing you guys. Now, how can people find you? What do you want people to know from this interview about you, about the group? You know, if you had to leave a message, what would it be? What would it be?
Well, again, like I said, it's going to be part of a new song that we have coming up, World Peace. We would like to see world peace. We would like to see a world where people come together. They can actually really live together. I know from a Islamic point of view, or a Christian, or a Jewish, everybody... we all hope for world peace. So I would have to say that. Why don't we? Why can't we make the world cool again?
Cooler than gang. Make it cooler than
America. Well, we're not making the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
What happened to the days of Adam and Eve? What the hell happened to the days? Let's go back to the beginning. How can we arrive at making the world cool again? Because we went in so many different worlds, so astray, so, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
That's my prayer. Let's make the world cool again.
Got you, brother. How can we find you? If there are social media, are you websites? You want to just give out that information so people looking you up?
I can it's coolagain.com.
Okay.
That's our website.
Okay, got to, okay.
It all falls on Spotify and all that high tech stuff. I leave that up to you. Know, I'm old school.
No doubt, no doubt.
I think my peoples, they have all of that. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, I'll say coolagain.com.
Got you. When does it? You ever thought about retirement? Have you ever considered retirement, or have you ever retired for a minute and came back? Have you ever stopped at all?
Say that one more time.
Have you ever retired for a moment and came back and said, hey, I'm not doing this no more? Or what do you, you know, because you're going, man. I mean, you've been doing this a long time.
I feel like I've been retired.
Yeah, you're right. That's right.
I've never been, I haven't been on the road for about 5 months. We were doing 100 shows a year.
Wow, man. That's incredible. That's incredible, man. That's incredible.
We're dealing with this. We're dealing with Zoom and social media. And
yeah.
You know, we're getting other things done.
Yeah.
You know, my partner and I, my cousin and I, Tony over there, sitting over there in the corner. We got various other projects.
Please, brother. Yeah. Okay.
I'm dealing with the project with Dusty Baker, Solar Energy. Called Cool Baker Energy.
Cool Baker. Gotcha.
At, you know, solar energy projects in Africa.
Nice.
We're dealing with... fertilizer, organic fertilizer.
Really? That's wow.
A project that my cousin over here, we're all working together on it.
Excellent.
I have a cologne called Just.
Really? Just. I like you that. Know. Where can we find that at? Where can we find that cologne at, man?
Well, it's right now, believe it or not, we got it kind of hung up in China right now. We got,
okay. I got
50,000 miles sitting over there, but it'll be coming.
Okay. I
mean, we're doing some promotions on it.
Okay.
And also, I have to say that we're doing a champagne called Le Cool Champagne.
Okay. All right. And all that stuff, once you get it, oh, that's it right there. Ah, can you put that bottle up a little bit? Can you?
There you go.
Beautiful bottle, man.
Cool.
Oh, look at that. Come on, man. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it, Ronald. Well, man, unbelievable.
Also
unbelievable.
Working on a non-alcoholic champagne as well.
Oh, that's interesting. That's interesting.
We'll work on that.
That's interesting. Wow. So you're busy. I'm talking about retirement. You ain't retired or nothing. You doing your thing, man. That's great, man. That's great, man. You know what? Like I said, I don't want to keep you for a long time because I can go on and on, man. But you know what? Thank you so much, brother. Thank you so much, man. You know, for coming on, man. And like I said, we're gonna get this to you. I'm gonna get it out to the people. And if there's anything that me, myself, Les Boogie can do for you, by all means, man, you pushing a product or whatever, man, just let us know. Let us know. We love you here in New York. We love you around the world. Cool in the Gang is us. We're y'all. You know, and just keep it going, man. And we're going to spread the word to the young people, man. So thank you, man. Thank you, my brother, for coming out, man, and sitting with me for a moment. It's been a pleasure.
I want to say one thing to you also. Yeah. Keep the spirit of the boogie. Let's boogie.
Yeah, my man. I like that. All right, now. I'll see you later, man. And thank you. All right.